Good morning. I have no idea what was just said about me. You were not laughing, so it can't be that good. It's an incredible honor and pleasure to be here. I literally just came from the airport. I woke up 4:30 a.m. this morning, flew in from Trondheim. So if my speech is a little slurry, I'm not drunk, just tired. Let's get this started. Alan Kay, he's one of the leading technologists. He worked at a place called Xerox PARC. And Xerox PARC in the late 60s invented pretty much everything and anything which you have today in terms of computer technology. They invented the laser printer, Ethernet, the touchscreen display, 50% of what makes the internet today. And Alan Park said in 1971, the best way to predict the future is to invent it. And this is what we want to do today. I want to show you today how we're inventing the future. And a way of showing you this is Alan. In 1968, he invented a piece of hardware which he called the Dynabook. So 1968, this is 5 years before I was even born. And at the time, he couldn't build it. Because the thing, when you look at it, this is a photo which was taken in the mid-2000s, where someone actually built a prototype based on those original sketches. At the time, it wasn't possible to build this, as you might imagine. But when you look at this, doesn't that look eerily like an iPad? So what this is to say is that if you put yourself into the right frame of mind and you understand what happens with technology in the future, you can actually predict the future, and thus you can build for this future. And I would argue, as leaders in organizations, this is what you have to do. And make no mistake, the future won't be incremental anymore. We will see some incredibly breakthroughs in terms of technologies in the next 5 to 10 years, if not earlier. And I'm going to show you a bunch of those today. And this is all based on one very, very simple principle, which we call exponentials. The simplest example I can give you for an exponential trend is Moore's law. Gordon Moore in the 1960s, 1970s predicted that computer chips will double in capacity every 18 to 24 months. And this has been steady holding up since then. So effectively what happens with this is an exponential trend. It gets double and double and double and double, so it's not linear growth. We're seeing exponentials in many, many other technology areas today. And this is what we're doing at Singularity University. We're studying them and we're teaching the principles behind them. And what I'm going to do today for you is, we have a 1 week program. I'm going to condense that 1 week program for you today into 45 minutes. And instead of having you pay $13,000 for it, you get it for free. Let's start with a very important distinction. And we're calling this the linear exponential deception. When you think linearly, your brain is wired to think linearly. This is how we think. And you think about taking 30 linear steps, one step after the other. That's about 30 meters. You've got an idea how far that is. For me, it's probably from here to the end of the curtain, somewhere there. And you also know how far half of that is. Now, I know this is a hard question because it's very early in the morning and you hopefully had a great night last night. How far do you get when you do 30 exponential steps? So every step is twice as far as your first step. Don't pull out your iPhone and do the math. What's your first guess? Just like someone just yelled something in the room. What's your first guess? How far do you get? Was that 900 meters? 10,000 meters? Reality is you get 25 times around the planet. That is exponential thinking. Now, you need to understand your brain is hardwired to think linearly. It's really, really hard for us humans to understand exponential trends. Let me put this a little bit into context. This is data coming from Eric Schmidt, former CEO of Google. So he commissioned a study. And what they looked at is, how much information did mankind produce from the beginning of time to the year 2003? So literally from the moment you like carved little like paintings into walls, to the Library of Alexandria, to the works of Beethoven. If you take all of that, it's 5 exabytes of data. That's a one with 18 zeros, 5 exabytes. The same amount of information has been produced in 2010 in 2 days. All of mankind's knowledge, 2 days. In 2013, we produce the same amount of information in 10 minutes. That is an exponential trend. So now it goes also the other way. It goes on the cost side as well. The cost of genome sequencing, the first time we sequenced the genome was in 1999. It was called the Human Genome Project. It took us about 6 years and cost us $3 billion. Very famous effort, amazing undertaking. In 2006, we did the same thing for $10 million in a couple of months. Last summer, a machine came on the market which does the whole thing in a couple of hours for about $1,000. When you talk to experts, they will tell you that in about 10 years, sequencing the human genome is effectively free. So every time you go to your doctor, you will get your genome sequence. There's people who will tell you that every time you flush your toilet, we will sequence your human genome just because we can and do analytics on your health status. So visualizing exponential trends to linear trends. So again, we're thinking linearly. This is how we're wired to think. Technology is, in large pieces, exponential. There's two interesting pieces in this curve. The one is where your linear thinking actually expects technology to be here. In reality, it's here. Because exponentials always start slow. And this is what we call disappointment. This is when you see technology and it's not quite there yet and you're disappointed by it. And then, when you come to what we call the knee of the curve, where these two curves cross, you then come into this point in time where you cannot even begin to imagine how fast this is growing. And this is what we call amazement and chaos. And you saw this, for example, with the mobile phone. I very, very distinctly remember buying the first smartphone, which was a Nokia device, which ran WAP, W-A-P. So it didn't even have the proper internet on it. And I was bitterly disappointed because it's a crap device. You couldn't do anything with it. Then the crossover point was when Steve Jobs came and showed the world the iPhone. Suddenly everybody knew how a smartphone has to look like and function. And now we can't even comprehend how fast the smartphone market is growing. There's now 3.45 billion mobile phone subscribers in the world. There's 7.1 billion people living on this planet. If you subtract the people who are like below the age of like whenever you get your first cell phone, let's say 9 years old, and you subtract the people who live in extreme poverty, we are now at nearly 100% cell phone coverage in the world. It's pretty crazy. This is amazement and chaos. Now, if you're staying on that line, and this is the message you need to take away, if you're staying on linear thinking, it's called the path to doom. This is basically where your company will go under. Another way to look at this is this graph. This comes from Ray Kurzweil, who's one of our co-founders, leading expert in artificial intelligence and an engineering director at Google. What they did was they took Moore's Law, and what he was interested in is saying, hey, Moore's Law was only established in the mid-70s or early 70s. If we're to taking Moore's Law and would project it backwards over a very long period of time, is it actually true? Is it still staying the same? And when you look at the axis, you see that this is actually a logarithmic scale. So it's not an exponential. It is a strong exponential. But because you can't draw it, it's drawn as a logarithmic scale. So two things are important to understand here. First of all, the exponential trend holds steady for hundreds of years, effectively since 1900, when it comes to Moore's Law. So Moore's Law is actually way, way, way more stable than what Gordon Moore even predicted. The second piece, and this is fun, is this goes from 10 to the power of minus 5 to 10 to the power of 10. So the delta is 10 to the power of 15, a 1 with 15 zeros. This is 1 million billion times. So the reason why we drew this, why we had to draw this in this way is, if you were to draw this in real life, and you would say the point on your most left side is 1 inch high, the point on the other side is 1 million billion inches high. That's 66,000 times to the moon. So if we were to draw this, the chart needs to go 66,000 times to the moon. So that's the power of exponentials. Now, there's something else happening. In 1903, at Kitty Hawk in the US, we flew the first time a plane, powered plane, Wright Brothers. In 1969, 66 years later, we flew supersonic for the very first time commercially with this beautiful bird. If you're taking all the technological change which has happened between 1900 and 1970 and index that, and you compare this with newer periods, the same amount of change, all of the technological change, not only the flight, but cars and washing machine and computers and phones, whatever you want, if you take all of that and you index it, the same amount of change we did in 70 years from 1900 to 1970, we did from 1970 to 2000. The same amount of change we did from 2000 to 2010, and the same amount of change we did from 2010 to 2014. So the rate of change is also exponentially increasing. And this is the part where you as humans, we as humans, sit there and we just can't keep up with what's happening. And I don't expect this to slow down. So rate of change is also increasing. Peter Diamandis has a framework for this, which he calls the 60s of disruption. They start out with deceptive. Exponential trends are always deceptive because they start really slowly. Because you start from 1 to 2 to 4 to 8, it's really slow. Ultimately, they become disruptive. This is the point where the curves cross. Anything and everything which can become digitized will become digitized. You obviously know this from music. It's happening in books and movies. But it goes way, way, way further than this. Also, anything and everything which can become dematerialized will become dematerialized. And we're seeing this with 3D printing, for example. So physical objects now become digital objects. Once they become digital, the money goes out of them. There is no material cost to Apple to sell you a song. The bits and bytes, once they're bits and bytes, distributing them becomes effectively free. So the money flows out of the system and ultimately becomes democratized. So it's an interesting framework to think about. Let me show you a little bit of like how this looks like in practical examples. And just to give you some context first, and this is for you as an audience. So when you look at something like retail, retail actually hasn't moved a lot. So this is like retail in, you know, 19, whatever, 20 stores. Then we had the first big revolution was to say, well, we take these little stores and we combine them in big stores and we move them from dense urban centers to the outskirts. So you had the birth of Walmart. Then you had someone came up with this grandiose idea of like, hey, I could sell stuff in catalogs. So you actually don't need to go to a store anymore. And then we took the catalog and put it on the internet. This is now, you know, whatever, $70 billion company. But it really, not a lot has changed. And I would argue this is true for advertising. The biggest breakthrough in advertising is that we now can measure from the customer interaction, which we could not do before. But it hasn't really changed that much. What we are now seeing is, I believe, we're seeing massive transformational change, and I'm going to show you a bunch of examples for that. Let's start with something called networks and computing systems. First example, this. This is super simple, right? Your cell phone will become effectively a digital identity, if it isn't already. So you will use this thing to pay, which is very obvious. There's numerous studies being done which show that people care more about their cell phone than their wallet. So when they go out, they're actually more attached to their cell phone than their wallet. So the moment you have that, it makes perfect sense to just put it into your cell phone. As a marketeer, for example, that means you need to be there, right? This is where the action is. This is the next iteration. So you go from cell phone to something you wear on your body. But actually, I don't care too much about these things. I think these are only transformational technologies. I think they will be actually superseded very quickly with something like this. This is a gentleman called Tim Cannon, who, granted, is slightly crazy. But what he did is he literally cut open his arm and inserted into his arm a mini computer. Now, this is the extreme version of it. And in his case, like, it's a big computer, so he's got like this big bulbous thing. It's kind of ugly. But the moment you start to get these things really, really small, you just put them into your body and you just carry them with you. Years ago, there was a club in Ibiza where you can insert a chip similar to a microchip for your dog, which you can use to pay. It's kind of limited in use because you can only use it to pay in one club, and I'm not quite sure if I want to have a chip in my body to pay in one club. But this is the future. I ultimately think that we will augment ourselves with computers in whatever form. and they will become our identities. You take something like iBeacons, Apple's technology to allow you to interact with your phone. You buy iBeacons today for $10, less than $10 in China. What this means is that you can actually sprinkle them around like dust. This is a German company. They're using iBeacons as well as streams from security cameras and other places to do live heat mapping in a physical store. Now, what's really fascinating is, so far, this has only been used to do kind of like a heat mapping and then analytics on top of that, and then you do like retroactively, you do something with this. This year, they're actually using this in a way that you call the store manager and you're saying, hey, I'm seeing there's traffic in like aisle 14. There's something going on here. Can you please put a different sign up there? So they're starting to optimize their physical stores in real time based on tracking data they get from cell phones. And this is the future. What you're seeing here is a golf ball. This is a dimple in a golf ball. And the little piece in there, the chip there, 2 millimeters by 1.6 millimeters. It's not only a chip. This is a computer on a chip. So if you remember like 99, 2000, your first Pentium computer, you know, like these big things you put your feet on and they were like loud and warm and fuzzy. This is roughly the same compute processing power. Now in like 2 millimeters by 1.6 millimeters for 75 cents if you buy more than 100,000. So you can buy these things today in Taiwan in quantities. Now, if I have a computer which is 75 cents, I just take anything and everything which has an electrical outlet and make it smart. And anything and everything which doesn't have an electrical outlet, I think about making it smart because it's free. I literally have free compute power. So we're moving into a world where the notion of like everything becomes smart, this Internet of Things topic which you're hearing, is overshadowed by people using it for arguably stupid things because we're trying things out. You're doing the smart toaster. But this is the real revolution. The real revolution is that you have computers which are so cheap that you just put them everywhere and anywhere. And they start to interact with you as well as with other computers. Now take this one step further. Let's go robotics and artificial intelligence. Now it gets really interesting. So you take something like this. This is Deep Blue, the computer from IBM, which famously beat the at the time the current world champion in chess in the mid-90s, late-90s. What's interesting about Deep Blue is chess is an inherently easy thing for computers to do because what you're doing in chess is you're just calculating steps ahead and then you apply logic against it which says like this move is most likely to be successful and then you just make the move. So ultimately you just need a very fast computer. This is what IBM did. What's interesting about Deep Blue is that Deep Blue barely won. Barely. A couple of years later, fast forward today, IBM has something called Watson. And Watson plays Jeopardy. And Jeopardy is probably the hardest thing for a computer to play because in Jeopardy, I don't know if you know the game, but in Jeopardy, the question is the answer. So you actually turn this thing around. You now need to reason. You can't just brute force your way into a solution by calculating odds and chances. You now need to reason. So now
you
can
play
Jeopardy.
Thank you for being here. What do you say we play Jeopardy? Let's get right into the Jeopardy round.
400, same category.
This mystery author and her archaeologist hubby dug in hopes of finding the lost Syrian city of Urkesh. Watson?
Who is Agatha Christie?
Correct.
Same category, 600.
So what's interesting about Watson is not only that it's a technical miracle for some, it destroyed the human opponents. It literally destroyed them. So Watson now is, when they did this is only a couple of years ago. When they did this, Watson was literally a room full of computers. It was 16 racks full of computers. Last year, Watson was 2 pizza box size computers. When you buy Watson, it's like 2 pizza boxes. This year, you buy Watson as a service. You pay it for the service. Similar to what Amazon Web Services does. Now think about what you can do with effectively artificial intelligence in the cloud on demand for close to free. This is interesting. Now let's talk about like what can you do with data. This is a visualization coming from Waze, which is a traffic app, which was bought by Google. So what you're seeing here is, what Waze does is, it takes traffic data and analyzes the traffic data to give you effectively a real-time live view of what's happening in a city. What's fascinating about Waze is you only need 5% of drivers to use Waze to get an absolute accurate picture of how a city looks like. So this is the power of big data. You actually don't need to have everyone to use this stuff. You only need a specific sample size, and then you effectively turn something which was a static system, a city, into something which is a living organism. Let's talk about this, self-driving cars. These things are here to stay, I can guarantee you that. Both NVIDIA, which is interesting, which is a graphics cards company, as well as Tesla, has just announced that they've basically solved the problem of self-driving cars, and then obviously Google is working on this. Let me quickly show you this clip.
Oh my God. Oh dear Lord.
Oh my God, this is so fucking awesome.
Oh my God.
So what's interesting about this is a couple of things. So first of all, this is the Google self-driving car, and they used it on a rooftop of a parking garage, and they set up like a little like obstacle course, and the car literally drives at basically the maximum of what the car could possibly drive at in terms of like acceleration and forces. So it's kind of scary, right? Like you're sitting in a car and it's effectively driving like a race course, which is the reason why you get like this really interesting human experience. So this is the naked truth of humanity when you're sitting in a self-driving car. What's fascinating is, fast forward this, like when you put the person in this car for the third time, they're sitting there and it's like, okay, what's now? Now, as a marketeer, it's an interesting question, because in the future, you will sit in that car and you don't have anything to do. So I would ask myself, like, how do I occupy people? Like, as a marketeer, perfect marketing opportunity right there. Like, you have me every day, 1 hour one way, another hour the other way. And these things I said, like, these things are coming. So really, really fascinating. Also fascinating, obviously, from a computational perspective. There's a lot of technology in these things. Let's go one step further. Let's say nanotech and digital fabrication. 3D printing, we all know. What's interesting about 3D printing is this is the first replicator from a company called MakerBot. MakerBot was recently sold, $400 million. The founder of MakerBot showed me this printer, the first make, years ago. And Bree Patta is the founder of MakerBot. And this is the power of exponentials. Bree Patta sits there. He understands what the power of exponentials looks like for digital fabrication and tells me, Pascal, this is going to change the world. Soon we will print anything and everything. Everyone will have one of those things on their desk, and we will just print everything we want. What I did was I saw a printer which is made out of plywood and has like weird cardboard on the side so it doesn't fall apart. And I couldn't see it. It was totally deceptive, because I saw plywood and, you know, I saw like a hobbyist project. I couldn't see the future Bree was seeing, but the future is here. So we print anything and anything. So we print fashion, we print guns, which is obviously very controversial. We print, when you go to a dentist in California, in Silicon Valley, there's no dentist, which take a 3D scan of your tooth. If you have a tooth replacement or a crown, they take a 3D scan, they print the tooth in ceramics while you're waiting for the tooth. So typical procedure, if you ever had that done, is like they take an imprint, send it to a lab, you need to come back 2 weeks later, typically it doesn't fit very well, then they have to like file it down. Now we're just taking 3D scan and print it. The thing on the black thing there is a cast. You break your arm, this comes out of our university, you break your arm, we 3D scan your arm or leg, we 3D print a cast, which not only looks wicked cool, it's also, when you need to scratch yourself, you don't need the ruler thing anymore. So that's nice. But what's fascinating is you see the wires there. So what this is actually a polymer which has metallic fibers in it. and the wires induce a very low current onto your bone, and that makes your bone heal 20% faster. So now your cast becomes active. What's interesting about 3D printing is that we are now starting to disrupt the disruptors. So in the this is just one example. You have a company called Warby Parker, very, very famous. They do glasses. They disrupted the market for opticians. They have a model where you buy the stuff and they send it to you, and they send you a couple and you can choose, etc. In the Netherlands, this company started to print glasses now. And they're not only printing the frame, they're actually printing the glass. And what they're doing is they're taking a picture with your cell phone, and they take optometrics on your phone and print glasses which are custom made for your face. So not only can you have the right width and length and temple length, but you're now also printing the glass in one piece. So this is happening all over the place. So digital fabrication starts to disrupt the disruptors. Let's talk a little bit about robotics. Robotics is a fun topic. These are really tiny robots. So this comes out of Stanford Research International. They are really, really small robots. They're incredibly fast. You see a coin as a size comparison up there. They do stuff like they can walk up and down. And they can swarm. So you can take a whole bunch of them and have them swarm. So this is what people now call smart dust. Because these things are literally the size of dust. So what do you do with these things? A lot. So one of the things is you can use them in medical situations, where you can actually insert them into the human body. And for example, if you have a gallstone or a bladder stone, you destroy the gallstone or bladder stone from inside out. You can imagine a future where you have tiny little robots repairing heart disease from inside out. Goes the other way as well. You can make big robots. You can make something like this here. So it's a little mean to kick this little robot, but what you're seeing here is this is actually really, really complicated to do. This here, most humans wouldn't be able to do. So we're seeing robotics, the whole point and the reason why I'm showing you this is we're seeing robotics now coming out of a very niche market, which was mass manufacturing, where you saw it in car manufacturing, et cetera, or very special use cases. We're now seeing robotics coming into daily life everywhere. And this is just two extremes, the very, very small robots, the really big robots, which are incredibly complex. But we will see robots, for example, in elderly care. We will see robots in typical home use cases. The idea of a robot cooking for you is not that far-fetched. We have a Roomba, right? We have a robot which cleans, which hoovers the floor for me. Why shouldn't I have a robot which cooks for me? To give you an idea how this looks like, when you go to an Orchard Hardware Supply store, which is a DIY market in the US, they have stores now in Silicon Valley which have this thing.
Retail really hasn't changed much in the last couple hundred years. The robots are the first thing that can really change the customer experience.
Hello, I am Oshbot, the Orchard Store robot helper. What are you looking for today?
The robot will come up to you and will say, hi, what can I help you with?
Where can I find more of these?
I'm looking for hammers.
Me gustaría comprar esto.
Can you place the object in my viewfinder? Is this the item you are looking for?
Yes.
I'll take you.
So it's kind of cute, and it still looks a little like it's coming out of a science fiction film. But now imagine, this thing is, so first of all, it speaks seven languages. It does image recognition. It's tied into the inventory system of the store. And it's starting to become fairly smart. So we will, as humans, we will interact with machines significantly more. And again, as someone in the media industry, as someone in the advertising, for example, I would think about how does this actually influence the way we are interacting with people and we present, for example, information. So a lot of that stuff is happening. What's, by the way, is funny is you see this on the robot here. They have a front screen, which is the active screen, and they've got a back screen, which is an advertising screen. So Let's come to augmented and virtual reality. And I know that there's a couple of sessions later on this too. Something I'm particularly interested in because I think it will fundamentally change the way we interact with the world. And this is something which is coming quicker and harder than a lot of people anticipate, I believe. So it starts with this. So you take something like Google Glass. This is the first prototype for Google Glass, Larry Page. Funny enough, a friend of mine built this. It took them about 2 hours to build the very first prototype because they literally took a coat hanger and a netbook and a display and like wired the stuff together to figure out like how does this work. In just 4 years, and this is the increasing rate of change, in just 4 years you went to a fully fledged product. Now you can argue if this is a good product or not, but coming from something which looks like a coat hanger to a deeply integrated system, which is, you know, arguably nicely designed, is pretty remarkable. Now, Google Glass is actually not that interesting as a product, I find. This is how it looks like if you haven't played with it.
Things now are coming up, like the weather, an upcoming flight, or an event in your calendar. You can tap on any card to see more. Swipe down anywhere to go back to the timeline. Cards to the right of the home screen are from the past. For example, messages, videos.
So you get the idea. So what Google Glass does is it basically has a little prism which projects information about your context. So for example, like an incoming text message or flight information into your field of vision. But it's this tiny little thing in the corner. It's not actually augmenting your reality. It's an information display. And I think this is where Google Glass got it wrong. Because I believe what we're seeing and the really useful cases are augmented reality. So to take you on that journey, this is a company called Meta One. You can buy this thing. This is a developer kit, but you can buy this thing today for $667. So it's not even expensive anymore. And what you do with this is something like this.
Holographic assistant. And you will be able to make it interactive as well. So let's say we mix the holographic assistance with a voice recognition software. So what you have is like a holographic Siri. Well, that's the second stage. And the third.
So the idea is you overlay your field of vision with information, with like, in this case, for example, an interactive football trainer. Now, this is version one. This is stuff you can buy today and you can play with it today. And even that I don't find so incredibly exciting. I don't know if you've seen Microsoft's HoloLens. HoloLens is taking this whole concept like three steps further. What they're actually doing is they're looking at your reality and starting to overlay your reality with stuff. And this looks this.
But what if we could go further? What if we could go beyond the screen? Where your digital world is blended with your real world. Now we can. This is the world with holograms. What will they enable us to do? New ways to visualize our work.
You know, I have an idea for the fuel tank.
New ways to share ideas with each other.
How are things going your end?
So this is the Microsoft version of the world. And this is not just like a fancy, nicely done video. This is actually working. So I tried these things out and I played Minecraft on a table where the glasses see the table and I can play Minecraft, which is basically Lego, and can put my Lego bricks on the table and they fall off the table when they're on the edge. Creates a really interesting question, which is, if you project this out, and you think about like the exponential trends, right? So currently this kind of like you wear these weird glasses and you look stupid, typical case of disappointment, right? Like, yeah, cool technology, but I wear look stupid. There's technology now which is used in fighter jets, where you use like information overlays for a really long time. Like they had these like head-up displays for a really long time, where you project with a laser right on the retina of the pilot. So they're actually wearing in their helmet, they have a tiny little like two lasers which project the image right onto the retina of the pilot. So when you get that smaller, you just put glasses on and you project a new reality onto your eyes. Which begs the question of the reality we're seeing today, the unfiltered reality. I believe that in the future, we will choose to not see that reality anymore. I believe that people in the future will spend significant amounts of time in an enhanced reality, in a reality where I don't know. I'm standing in front of a group of like, and you all look like aliens because I'd like it. Or I'm nervous and I'm like, I can't spend time in front of a lot of people, so I just make you disappear while I'm speaking. There's a lot of really interesting use cases. And then obviously this begets again the question, like you will most likely not show banner ads in something like this. This here came out last night. I'm super, super excited about this. This is a company called Magic Leap. Google just poured $500 million in venture capital into this company. They're doing something similar to what Microsoft HoloLenses are doing. So again, like it's an augmented reality overlay. They're super secretive. Like nobody really knows what the product looks like. This came out last night and it's pretty cool. Get the idea. Besides the fact that I'm like, I just want to play that game. But you start to understand what happens here. Like the idea of like our reality will actually change. And I want to bring you back to like, so this is the future, and it's probably not necessarily the too far off future. But to bring you back to like today, there's a company, a tiny little company called IKEA, which happens to make the second most printed object in the world, other than the Bible, called the IKEA catalog. When you have an IKEA catalog today, you can download an app on your iPhone and you can do this. This is available in the App Store today. What it does is it knows how the IKEA catalog looks like, so it has a mental image of what the catalog looks like and starts projecting three-dimensional objects into this catalog. So you can then see how a specific table or you know a chair or whatever you want to look at looks in your environment. So this stuff is coming. Let's take this one step further, virtual reality. So what we talked so far about is augmented reality. So I'm still in my own reality. I'm just like choosing to augmented or probably replace certain things. Now we're taking one step further, we're going into virtual reality. Virtual reality looks something like this. You put on these goggles. The goggles have a 120-degree field of vision and they do motion tracking, so they know which direction you're looking at. And they're also like two different fields, so you actually get a three-dimensional view. And this is the view you're getting when you're like stepping into a reality like this. You're literally stepping into a completely new reality. Now you can use this for a lot of use cases. So this is done by Topshop in the UK, which use these virtual reality glasses to put you into a fashion show. So they're using a live stream with a three-dimensional camera. It's a 360 camera. You put on these glasses, and now I'm literally in the fashion show. What I find most fascinating about this video is just look at the facial expression of the women in 1 second. There. It's utter disbelief. Like we have these things in our lab, and when you put this on, it's crazy because you're like, you are in a different place. You can use this for travel. So we're working with Marriott, and Marriott is asking themselves the question of, if I can step into a new reality, do I actually want to go on vacation anymore? Do I need to see the Tower of Pisa in real life when I can experience it with my goggles?
What feature is that? I want to go to that one.
So they've built a little prototype where they basically put people in a beach and on top of a skyscraper because they're actually concerned about what this means for their world. So this is the funniest one. So this is happening. This is not filmed by us, but this is happening in my lab all the time. So there's a what you're going to see is this gentleman is on a roller coaster, right? He's got these goggles on, and I just leave you to it. So you're seeing basically what he's seeing is on the screen, and it's a three-dimensional roller coaster.
If he breaks Tavis's computer.
So the crazy thing about this is, besides the fact that it's pretty hilarious, and literally this happens in our lab all the time when I put people on the roller coaster, is it takes you about 10 to 20 seconds to completely lose your sense of reality. Like people lose their sense of like, even the sense of like that you're not actually moving, which is crazy because you're stationary. But you believe you're on this roller coaster. I've got people, I stand behind people and hold them because they're like swaying and like sometimes fall. It's really fascinating when you think about like what this means in terms of like the realities we like people will choose to live parts of their lives in these virtual realities. There's an interesting piece about this, which is you need to come to the point where technology is good enough. If you take, for example, the resolution of your eye, so when you today when you look at an Oculus Rift, it has a resolution of about 300-350 DPIs, dots per inch, which is about what your iPhone has. Your eye has a resolution of, at this distance, because you have the glasses at this distance, has a resolution of about 1,000 DPI. So we are 3x off from in terms of resolution. So you still see pixels. Your brain still thinks like this is not real. When you get to 1,000 DPI, and we will get to 1,000 DPI, this is real. There's no difference anymore. This is a video which is super, super exclusive, like, and I love it. So this is Trip Hawkins, the founder of EA. This is an internal video they released into Electronic Arts about 30 years ago. They're talking about what they see as the future. This is what they said 30 years ago.
It's possible for a computer to provide a world where the rules are open-ended, where if you're flying around a planet and decide to take off toward that star, you can.
We can evoke in people a sense of, wonder, curiosity, intrigue. Maybe a little smile for a grandson who learned how to do something on a grandfather's machine.
But I'd like to write some software that interacts with you in a way that's really closer to the way a person would interact with you.
You may become attached to some of the software characters, and you may develop emotional feelings about some of the personalities in the software.
That's why I've been mentioning the idea of a software friend, and that sort of should be built into a computer, but it can be built into a program too.
A lot of good designs just cause you to smile. I mean, you look at it and you want to smile.
It's remarkable that like 30 years ago, Trip Hawkins and his little group of electronic game designers actually came up with this vision of the future, because I believe that is what we are moving into today. So let me quickly wrap this up. There's something interesting happening here, which is the shifting grounds. This example is fairly well known. You've got Kodak. Kodak 1996 was a really big company, 140,000 employees, $28 billion in market cap, 2012 bankrupt. What's remarkable about Kodak is Kodak invented the digital camera. Classic example of not seeing an exponential trend. The team at Kodak invented the digital camera, but it has 0.5 megapixels because first version. And they didn't see it. They were like, nobody will want this. Film will always be better. This will never go. Now, the same year as they went bankrupt, this little company called Instagram was bought for $1 billion. There's an argument to be made that Instagram kind of like is the demise of the Kodak of this world. And they did this with 13 employees. So grounds are shifting. There's another shifting ground, which is I actually believe we'll see now the disruptors being disrupted. We talked about Warby Parker earlier. This is Skype. Skype has 100 million active users, $8.5 billion acquisition from Microsoft. Now, if you compare this, WhatsApp. WhatsApp was a $21 billion acquisition, granted, quite expensive, but they had 500 million users. Skype is today the largest telecommunications provider in the world, bar none. These guys are five times as big. So we're seeing these cycles now getting faster and faster and faster, talking about the rate of change. And the question then becomes for me, what happens to Skype? So here's the big picture. What you want to look for in the future is, I believe, like four really big trends. The customer experience is shifting. Personalization becomes standard. People will just demand that the product they buy is going to be personalized to them in whatever fashion. This might be because it's personalized in size, in style, whatever it is. And technologies like 3D printing are on your, are helping you with that. Efficiency and costs will go up significantly. We will come to this point where like stuff just becomes super, super cheap and effectively abundant. And lastly, we're taking more and more and more atoms and turn them into bits. So you remember this guy? In a lot of technologies, you're literally at this point, like at this crossover point, or briefly before that. Let me end. So for everyone in this room who is not a CEO, not owns his own company, take this clip with you. We're going back to Alan Kay.
So on the other hand, we spent roughly 2 to 3 times a person's salary each year just on technology for that person. Because we were buying, as I'll show you, we bought our way into the future. Because Moore's Law says that if you're interested in something 15 years from now, you can have that computing power now if you're willing to pay through the nose.
So next time your boss tells you that you can't buy the new iPhone, show him this. No, really, I mean, there is a point to be made, which is I actually believe you all should spend money on technology because you can buy tomorrow's technology today. You don't need to buy 20-year technology, like the technology which is 20 years out. You can buy the technology which is 3 to 5 years out. You just need to pay for it. So as a last thing, I want to leave you with a Chinese proverb, and some people say it's a curse. And it says, may you live in interesting times. And I believe in interesting times we do live. And if you ever want to get in touch with me, I've got the easiest email address on the planet. Just letter P at singularityu.org. Thank you.
Thank you, Pascal. Quick question, ending question.
Sure.
I think we discussed a bit about what about the human factor in terms of acceptance of technology, especially political, religious, cultural issues. How do you look on that?
Yeah. So human factor, I think is there's two interesting things happening. So first of all, there's a human resistance. So I give this talk, a modified version of this talk, to lots and lots of people. Including politicians. And I recently had a delegation from the German Bundestag, and literally their first comment was, typically people are fairly upbeat about technology, their first comment was like, how can we regulate this? And I can tell you, you can't, because, well, you can, but your regulation is always too slow, and especially if like we believe that you know technology is iterating quicker and quicker and quicker, you can't actually get your way out of this. I think, so there's a human resistance against this, and we're trying to like brace ourselves and like put the brakes on this stuff. On the flip side of that is for everyone who has got kids, like kids just gobble up this stuff. They will like, for me, like I don't even bother trying to convince a 50-year-old about this stuff. I'd rather spend time with a 12-year-old, and you know get them to do this. So. In a lot of ways, I think, to your question, like the iteration cycles, I think what happens is that it's really driven from like younger folks, like, and it's coming up from them, and they will push it into the mainstream.
Okay, thank you. Give it one welcome.
Thank you.